If you're visiting, we appreciate you visiting. Hope that you'll continue to visit with us and come back and be a part of us as well. And we hope that you've had a good week, each and every one of us. We have a beautiful day today. It's already been discussed several times about Asheville and other places that are kind of west of us as well. The tragedy that they have, all the floods and all the broken up homes and things like that with the damage to the wind, the hurricane. So of course our prayer is going to be for them each and every day until they recover, which I'm sure will take a long time. But if you would, look with us this morning inside of our bulletin and let us go over all of our things that we have to mention this morning. It says that the CUOC collection for the month of October is going to be rice and canned beef stew. The Old Union Women's Mission for the fourth quarter, which is October through December, will be the hospice house. Cleaning the church month of October will be Ronnie Johnson, if she's able, and if not, then I'll help her do that, okay? The Bible study that we have on Wednesday nights is growing. We're very thankful for that. If you would like to be a part of it, it starts at 6:30, and most of the time we're out by 7:30, between 7:30 and 8 always, in the fellowship hall. The youth ministry is still selling shirts. We have black shirts, white shirts, and gray shirts, as well as some hats if you're interested. Sign-up sheet is in the back. The military and honor memorial wall, if you know of anyone who has served or who has been a member or attended Old Union in the past or the present, please give Susan Wilson, she's right back there, their name and or a picture of them so that they can be added to the wall. The finance committee meeting will be today, immediately after the worship service in the sanctuary. The members are Jenny Frazier, Tamara Perez, D.W. Coggins, Kathy White, Loretta Smith, Gene Farlow, Kelly Smith, Daryl Spielman, Robert Wilson, Lisa Luckadoo. Is that how you pronounce that? I like Luckadoo, so that's what we're going to stick with. And Ronnie Johnson, okay? But either way, Lisa knows who she is, and she's not here today. So Old Union Women's Meeting for Tuesday at 6 p.m. By Zoom, okay? The invitations will be emailed out tomorrow. There is going to be a pastor appreciation cover dish meal on Sunday, October the 20th, immediately after the worship service in the fellowship hall. Everyone bring a meal to share, and I do thank you. There will be a Halloween party taking place on Saturday, October the 26th. The schedule for the events are as follows, okay? Starting at 5 p.m. sharp, there will be a costume contest for all ages, approximately 5 p.m. until 7. We will be eating and having hay rides. The menu is chili beans with all the fixings, pimento cheese sandwiches, peanut butter sandwiches, approximately from 7 p.m. until 8. There will be games and the dessert walk under the shelter. And approximately 8 p.m. will be a haunted trail. And we are asking for big bags of candy to be donated and desserts for the dessert walk. And anyone that would like to help on the haunted trail, there is a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. The regularly scheduled board meeting for Sunday, October 27th will be immediately after the church in the sanctuary, and we will be voting on the nominations and the budget for 2025 at this meeting, among other items. And the last thing is the Old Union's Women vendor event has been canceled, okay? Is there any more announcements anybody does know of this morning?
The men will be starting selling shoulders for Thanksgiving this week, and it'll be $55 a piece.
Okay, so if you're interested in buying a shoulder, then we discussed that this morning. There'll be a $55 a piece, and you can go ahead and put your order in, and they'll be ready, what, the day of Thanksgiving or day before?
Day
before Thanksgiving, so if you're interested. And they do a good job, and they cook.
Anybody has anything for the newsletter, I need it today or tomorrow.
And the newsletter needs to be for the Bill's messenger and needs to be turned in today to Jeffrey. Okay. Any more announcements? All right. If you'll look on the back, you'll see all the names and everything. Some were added, some were taken off this morning as well. So let me ask you this morning, is there anybody else that we may need to add to our prayer request list as far as sickness or health or any other needs? Is anybody we need to add this morning?
I have a praise.
Yes,
we
sir.
We did get the rights taken away from Daisley's
Yes, sir.
That's one less hurdle, so hopefully.
That's a great blessing.
We'll get a doctor here soon.
That's right. Just keep praying about that. Still a few more things to do, okay? Anybody else this morning?
And the plans are that Samantha will have the baby sometime this week.
So do pray for Samantha.
That is the plan.
I started to say, and Mark does need your prayers, but of course Samantha's gonna need them more, okay? Yes, Brother Donnie?
We can remember my kids, they woke up, both of them with fever, was up all night, they, mom, she's still, she could probably have her out of the woods.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Is there something in the water, Donnie, or what? Yeah?
I don't know. We got septic tank, we went to City Sewer and thought that might help.
Yeah, I remember, yeah, yeah.
I ain't quite sure, ain't got it figured out.
They just stay sick all the time, I'm sorry. Do pray for Donnie's kids, appreciate it very much. Anybody else this morning before we go to the Lord in prayer?
I went to see Ben Jefferson this week.
Oh, you did?
He just can't breathe.
Yeah, sir.
He told me to tell everybody hello. He called his church family to me. And he said Carol's, she done forgot about the trip they went on.
Oh, really?
Just remember that.
Yeah, do. I understand. Do pray for Ben. Did you pet his little dog?
I didn't go in the house.
Okay, all right. Anybody else this morning? Do pray for Ben and Carol. All right, well, once again, thank you for being here. And we did get the fellowship hall painted this week, me and my son. If you hadn't seen it, then be glad to look at it. If you have any problems, just don't hesitate to let me know. But I think it looks all right, okay? Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Our Heavenly Father, as always, we thank you for the privilege and opportunity we have to be here in your house this morning. And Father, on behalf of each and every one of the names and the needs of the people that's been mentioned this morning, those are written down, those upon our heart, and those have been voiced out, we do pray for your mercy and thank you for your mercy. We do pray for your leadership and guidance. And we do ask you, Father, in Jesus' name, as always, dear God, to continue to help us that we might be that you'd have us to be for the namesake of the Lord Jesus Christ and the building of the kingdom of God. Continue to bless all Union as well as the other ministries that God tried to make up your church. And God, I pray for each and every heart and each and every need here today that God, your will be done. Have mercy and may we forever give you the praise. In Jesus' name I ask and thee pray these things. Amen and amen. All right, Miss Susan, are you reading the Psalms? If you'll look up to, if you'll focus towards the front, just as soon as Miss Susan reads the first line, if you'll follow in behind and read the second line, we'd appreciate that this morning.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart, and the commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey, and the drippings of the honeycomb.
Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them there is great reward.
But who can detect one's own errors? Clear me from hidden faults.
Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
All right, thank you very much, Miss Susan. Okay. My wife is going to try to sing a song for you this morning. If you'd pray for her, I'd appreciate that very much. Okay.
Day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling, with joy I am telling, He made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Oh, what a standing is mine! And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came, took of the offer of grace He did proffer. He saved me, oh, praise His dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Now I've a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believed. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I received. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
You hear, do you like to sing in the choir? Just come on up and make it count.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers.
We're always looking for volunteers to sing.
But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the light, and it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only way.
Ah,
she's
coming
over
here. Come on, girlfriend.
All right,
I'll get you. And I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't
all
care
I
if they remember me. Only Jesus.
Oh, anywhere.
And
okay.
Jesus.
Statement of our faith this morning says, I believe in God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
CCLI, you may be seated this morning. It's time for the little children, so all you little children, if you would come to the front this morning, you know what to do.
Everybody today. Oh, well, I just found out that we have a special birthday today. Do we have any birthdays to celebrate? Nora, right here. So, Nora, tell everybody how old you are today.
I am six.
Yay! Yay. Happy birthday, Nora. Is there any other birthdays? Another number in front?
Just barely.
Just barely. She's a little older than you, Nora. Sandy. Is that it? Sandy and Nora?
Amari's Friday.
Whose? Amari's was Friday? Okay. He was sick. Oh, you and Amari are the same age now. Yes, honey. Your daddy's. It was? Did we sing to him already? Okay. He said we sang to him. Thank you for telling me. Let's sing Happy Birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And do we have an anniversary to celebrate?
No. Did I tell mine last week?
No, I didn't.
Mine and Kelly's was last week. It was 19 years last week.
Who?
Mine and Kelly's.
Oh, it was? Oh.
19 years.
Oh, congratulations. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. Wow, you snuck that one in. I know, exactly. Well, today we're going to talk about the Trinity. We have talked about this before, but our visitor, my granddaughter Raven, she has not heard this, and I'm not sure if everybody was here because this was way back in April. So what we're going to talk about is I have these apples, and I have an apple that's sliced so you can see inside of it, okay?
Yes.
And, yeah, let's look inside of that apple. Okay. Okay, so first you have the whole apple. It looks like this. You have one entire apple. Now, there's three different parts to this apple. So the Trinity has three different parts. In the Bible, you have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. So, yeah, or Spirit, either one. God, the Holy Spirit, He's our helper. God is three in one. Well, this apple is three in one. You know what the three parts are?
Yeah.
Just as this apple. So I cut this open. So what you have here, Raven, could you hold this, sweetie? This part right here? Thank you. So what you have is the outer part, which is, I guess you call that the skin of the apple? The peeling? Yeah, the peeling. And then on the inside, you have the apple flesh. That's the part that you eat, although some people do eat the peeling too. But on the very inside of it, you have seeds. Seeds, right. Now, that the seeds are deep down inside of the apple, and you can't see them unless you cut it open. See how that's whole? You can't see it. You don't know they're in there until you cut it open and you don't eat the seeds. But anyway, the Holy Spirit, when you accept the Lord as your Savior, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. And you can't see that part, but he's there. And so that's the Trinity. You have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so there's only one God with three parts. And there's also an apple that has three parts. So I want you to know that the seeds inside of this apple, they're not going to be able to grow in the ground unless you care for them and you nourish them and you water them. And that's how it grows. So that's what you have to do with the Holy Spirit that is inside of you. You have to nourish it and make it grow, like through God's word and reading the Bible and coming to church, just like the apple grows. And so you have to grow in the Lord. And so I hope that you remember that, the Trinity. Who do we have? We have God, the Father.
And God, the
Holy Ghost, and the Son. And that's what we have. And so remember that. Maybe you'll remember that when you eat an apple, that you'll remember the three parts, and just like the apple has a three part. Okay, so let's get our prayer fingers together. You guys ready to pray? Are you ready to pray? Michael Hall. Okay, let's get our prayer fingers together. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the Trinity, Lord. You are complete in the Trinity, and we are complete through you. Thank you, Father, for every single child that is represented here today, every family, every member and visitor that came to Old Union today. Bless them in a great way for coming to worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, okay. Now you get one of these. Oh, my goodness. Happy birthday, Nora.
Yes. Children, okay?
Are you okay?
All right. Okay, church, if you would, one more time, look towards the screen this morning and read the Lord's Prayer along with us. It says, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. All right. Thank you very, very much, Ted. If you do have a Bible, if you turn to the book of Ephesians with us this morning, I'm going to give you two places to turn if it's where you can or if you're able. We just want to read you a couple of verses out of Ephesians this morning. But in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5. The book of Ephesians, chapter number 5 this morning. And also, if you have a bookmark or something, if you want to turn over to the book of Hebrews, chapter number 9, that's where we'll be next. Just want to read you two verses in Ephesians chapter 5. Thank you for being here, and thank you for being a part of Old Union this morning. Let's read verses 1, verses number 2, and then we'll have a word of prayer, okay? The Bible says in Ephesians 5, 1 and 2, Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also have loved us, and have given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling Savior. Let us pray. And followers, we've read a couple scriptures, and by all intents plan to read several more. We just pray that your word will once again come alive within our hearts and our homes and our families and our church and in our neighborhood and community and even on our jobs. Help us to always realize the great foundation that we have to stand upon is your word. And God, I pray that thou would open up our hearts, our eyes, and our ears this morning. Help us to receive that. God, Father, may you touch and anoint of all thy servant as well. Give me leadership and guidance, the words that need to be spoken this morning. And I pray to God, Father, that your will forever be done, that Jesus forever be glorified. For it is in his name we pray and ask these things. Amen. I want to speak to you just a few minutes this morning, church, on behalf of what we find here in verse number 2, where it says, and Jesus Christ gave himself as an offering and a sacrifice to God, which represented that sweet-smelling Savior. You may know, if you study your Bible at all, and I encourage you always to study and read, you may know that God has always required a sacrifice for sin. And the very first sacrifice that ever was created or committed was committed by God himself. We know that Adam and Eve, they had sinned in the Garden of Eden, and which they had no clothes on at the time, but there was nothing wrong with that, the way God created them. But once they had sinned, they realized that they didn't have no clothes on. So God clothed them. And the way that he clothed them, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 3, verse 21, is he took and made coats of skin. So there was some animal, it don't say what type of animal, but there was some type of an animal that God destroyed or killed or took the life of that day to cover the sin of Adam and Eve. And ever since then, there has been sacrifices of bulls and rams and goats and all kinds of different animals. And if you do like to read, I want to give you some good reading this morning in your spare time. If you'll start in Exodus chapter number 25, Exodus chapter number 25, and you begin to read that particular chapter as well as all the way through, you'll find out that there's a whole lot of scripture concerning the tabernacle of God, and you also find out a whole lot of scripture concerning the sacrifices of God as well. And in the midst of that reading, you'll also find out all the details that God required during this sacrifice, how it should be and by what type of animal, and not only the animals, but there was other sacrifices as well. There were daily sacrifices, but once a year, and I'm sure most of you know this, okay? Once a year, God required the priest to offer sacrifice for the sins of all the people. And in this particular offering, we know that the temple, which I love to study the temple and the tabernacle of God, we also know that within this temple, okay, there was a place called the Holy of Holies that only the priest himself could go into. And you also find out in that reading, the book of Exodus, I'm just trying to give you a little introduction here. In that book of Exodus, you'll find out that God even required the priest to have bells around the robe as they went into the Holy of Holies. Now, the reason why the bells were around the robe is because nobody was allowed into the Holy of Holies to offer the offering except for the high priest. And if those bells ever quit making a racket, making a sound, then that means he was dead. And you might say, well, I don't know about that, preacher. Well, you'll find out that Aaron was a priest that God ordained to go in and offer the offerings. And you'll also find out that two of Aaron's sons died while they were offering the offer on the altar to the Lord. Sin, even though sometimes we take it lightly, and I'll get to the message real quick in Hebrews chapter 9, even though we take sin lightly a lot of times, there was a great sacrifice that had to be made for you and I to be able to be here this morning. And that sacrifice is what we find in verse number 2. The Bible says, walk in love as Christ also have loved us and have given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling Savior. Now, over in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 9, I just want to give you several scriptures this morning concerning the sacrifice and concerning the Lord Jesus Christ and the price that he truly did pay. In Hebrews, chapter number 9, look with me, verses 2 through verses number 7. Verses 2 through verse number 7. Bible says, there was a tabernacle made, the first wherein was the candlestick, and the table, and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called, as I just said, the holiest of all, which had the golden censer, the ark of the covenant, overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot, that had manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant. And over it the cherubims, or the angels of the glory, shattering the mercy seat, of which we cannot speak particularly. Now, the reason why the writer says I can't tell you a whole lot about the mercy seat is because this particular writer had never been there and never taken part of it. And what the high priest done is they took the blood of bulls and goats and calves, whatever God required, and as he went into the Holy of Holies, okay, there was an altar, just like we have an altar here this morning. And what God required was for that particular sacrifice, the blood. It's always been the blood. It will always be the blood, okay? We know that Cain and Abel, they offered a sacrifice, but the only one that was accepted was Abel's because he offered the blood. And what Cain offered was the vegetables. So we know that what Aaron did is he went in with the blood of the bulls and calves, whatever God required, and he sprinkled it and laid it upon the altar, the Bible teaches and tells us. And the reason why that nobody else knew about this mercy seat, because there was a mercy seat there that was sprinkled with the blood, that God would show mercy upon all the people that were on the outside of the sanctuary itself. And that's exactly what Jesus did as well. But verse number 6, we'll get to that. Verse number 6 says, now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. Now the service of God is all the things we just read. The golden candlesticks, the fires, everything that was burning, everything that had to be taken care of and looked after daily. This is what they did. The priests went in, they handled everything, took care of everything. Just like they light the candles here, that was a job that had to be done, make sure the candles were lit. The fire was always lit. It never went out. And there's a lot to do around the house of God that needs to be taken care of. And sometimes a lot of people take it advantage or take it for granted that everybody else or somebody else would do what needs to be done. But you know what? There's always something for everybody in the house of God to do. And I've told you before, if you ever want to do something, you ain't got nothing to do, come see me. I'll find you something to do. That ain't no problem at all. It might be raking leaves. It might be moving limbs as we moved this morning out of the driveway and stuff. It might be mopping the fellowship hall, even though we mopped it. Probably could use a good mopping right now. In fact, it probably could use a good buff and a good wax on it. So, I mean, I'm just thinking. I can go ahead and give you some jobs right now if you're interested. But there's always something to do around the house of God. But the problem is a lot of times people think, well, somebody else will do it. Well, what's wrong with you doing it? Why can't you do it? Why can't you help out? Why can't you do your part as well? The least little thing sometimes that you might do might make a great impression on somebody else. But these priests, they had a job to do every single day. And that job was to make sure that everything in the first sanctuary was just the way God required it. But then it says in verse number 7, but unto the second went the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people or the sins of the people. So God has always required that sacrifice, and it's because of sin. And God will always require that he requires without question from anybody. It's simply what he has ordained and the way he wants it. But then look with me verse number 11. We're going to skip just a few verses. Verse number 11 says, but Christ, now pay attention to what it says, but Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Now we also know this morning, that this particular tabernacle that the priest went into, it was all made, okay? It was all made by man. The bricks, the mortars, whatever it was made, the trees from Lebanon. And it's always encouraged me. I've always been very excited about the building of the temple. And maybe when we get done with the book of Revelations, which is what we're going through in Bible study, we might focus our attention over to the temple, how it was made and how many days and years and labor it took and all the gold and all the precious things that God wanted everything done just the way it needed to be done. But that was a man-made building, just like what we're sitting in this morning. And that's where the priests went into that man-made building, and they accomplished everything that God wanted accomplished each and every single day, versus as well as once a year for the sins of the people. But the Bible says in verse number 11, okay, but that's not what Christ came for. Christ didn't come to go into the Holy of Holies as far as the building that was made by hand. Christ didn't come to offer sacrifice as the rest of the high priest did through the first gate and through the sanctuary, and then go into the altar and kneel down before that altar in a building that was made by hand. Christ didn't come and do the job that the rest of the priests tried to do every single year and offer that particular sacrifice before God in a building. But what Christ did, okay, Christ offered himself, as the Bible says in the book of Ephesians. He offered himself unto God, not within a building made by hands, but in the tabernacle and building of his own life and his own body. Most of us know the scripture this morning about we are the temple of God. It's been said many times about how we represent that tabernacle. Not made of bricks and mortars, but now the tabernacle of God and the temple of God are you and I. And the reason why we are that is because of Christ, the great high priest. Verse number 12 says, neither by the blood of goats or in calves, but by his own blood he entered into once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and ashes of heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying the flesh, then how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Now the difference between the blood that Christ offered himself and the blood that all these high priests offered was simply this, okay? The sins of the people, they were only looked over for that year until the next year when sacrifice was offered again. And the Bible says the blood of the bulls and the goats and things like that, they sanctified and purified the flesh for 1 year. But the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, who was without spot, without sin, the Bible says he was able to purge our sins, to get forgiveness of our sins through his own precious blood, not the blood of bulls and goats and calves and things like that. But then look with me in verse number 19. 19 says, for when Moses had spoken, every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the testimony which God had enjoined unto you. So moreover, he sprinkled the blood, both the tabernacle, all the vessels of the ministry, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. For it was therefore necessary that the patterns of the things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. Now what Moses and all the other priests did is they simply kind of drew a picture of the things of what heaven was going to be like, and they simply anointed and sprinkled the blood on all the earthly things, which gave a shadow of what heaven would be like one day. But that's not what Christ done. Bible says, verse number 24, for Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, that particular building, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. So what Moses and Aaron and all the other priests did, they went into a building like we've got here, and they went up to the altar like we got right here, and they went up towards the mercy seat, okay? And what they did is they took the blood with them, the bulls and the goats and the calves, and they offered that blood, which appeared to be a type of heaven, a type of holy of holies, and a type of place where God would dwell. And what they did is they offered that particular blood for the sins, for a covering of the sins of the people that had come that day to get forgiveness or to get cleansed. But see, that's not what Jesus did. The Bible don't say that Jesus went into this tabernacle. The Bible don't say that Jesus went up to this altar made by man. The Bible don't say that Jesus went up to this mercy seat that was built out of wood to offer an offering unto God. But what Jesus Christ did is he went straight to heaven. And he knelt down before God, his heavenly Father. And with the blood of bulls and goats and calves left behind here on earth, he offered his own precious blood on the mercy seat that day. The Bible says, for Christ is nigh entering to the holy holies made with hands, which are the figures of the true things, heaven, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us, nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest enter into the holy place every year with blood of others. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world have he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Now, as I've already said three or four times, each and every single year, the priests had to slaughter goats and rams and calves. They had to take that blood, and it had to be done a particular way for God to be pleased, to give them a cleansing until the next year, and then the next year, and then the next year, okay? They went through this ritual, this tradition every single year just to see and feel the presence of God in their life, to know that they've been cleansed from their sin and cleansed from the wrongdoing that they had committed during that year. Oh, but what Jesus done and what nobody else could do, what no other man was able to do, okay, is he took his own precious life. He took his own precious blood and he knelt down before his heavenly Father and he placed his own blood on the mercy seat one time, the Bible says. And that one time was good enough to suffice God. The Bible says that if his blood would not have the ability to forgive you of your sins, then what he would have to do is come back and die every single year and offer his blood every single year, just like the priest did. Oh, but listen, God was sufficed with that. God was pleased with that. God realized the only way for man to get forgiveness of their sins is to have the perfect one, the Holy One, his only begotten Son, as the supreme sacrifice that ever has been. And no longer were priests invited to come to the altar. No longer was it required for bloods of bulls and calves and goats to be killed. Because at this particular point, the very day that Jesus knelt down before God and said, Father, it is finished, and offered his blood on the mercy seat, then God required no more sacrifice after that. The Bible says in verse number 27, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look to him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Now we that are Christians, and we that know what forgiveness is all about, we that have accepted the blood that was shed on Calvary, we that have looked to the Savior for the forgiveness of our sins, we look now for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We don't look for him to come back again and offer his life again. We don't look for him to come and be sacrificed again. We look for him to come and step out on the clouds and say, come up hither, those that know him as Lord and Savior. The Bible says that there was only one sacrifice that could forgive our sins or man's sins, and that was the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. Now, if you would look with me in Hebrews chapter number 10, just a little bit more. Verse number 3 through verse number 17, I'll read quick. Bible says, but of those sacrifices, okay, there is a remembrance again made of sins every single year. Now y'all know I ain't very big on telling jokes, just every now and then, okay, just rare course, okay, but let me, it goes along with the verse. There's a preacher preaching, Man just stepped out of the pew and bawling like a baby. Ran to the altar, fell down the altar, crying. Preacher got down and said, "Brother, what is the matter?" He said, "I have to confess I stole a bunch of chickens last night." He said, "Well, you know the Lord will forgive you, right?" He said, "Well, I know the Lord forgive me. I know the Lord loves me." He said, "Well, brother, you just ask the Lord forgive me, you're going back to your seat." So he stayed down a little bit. He got up, went back to his seat. Preacher went back to preaching. Well, but just a few minutes later, here comes the same man, just a running and just a bawling like a baby. Fell down the altar and just crying out to God. So the preacher goes back down again. Said, "Brother, I thought we had this all settled." "Oh, we did. We did. I know." He said, "Well, why are you back down here again?" He said, "Because I'm going back tonight and get some more." Bible says in verse number 3, "But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year." See, Christ came and died for your sins, friend, one time. One time. He didn't come to die for your sins over and over and over. Therefore, once God has forgiven you of that particular sin or all your sins, then you are forgiven. And there should not be any remembrance of that sin. The Bible says once God forgave you, he took, okay, and spread your sins as far as the east is from the west, not to remember them anymore. Now, you and I both know that our enemy, he always reminds us of who we are. And he always wants to remind us of just how dirty and low down at one time we were. Not that we're perfect now, not that we have arrived, not that we've earned any kind of special reward, okay? But what we do need to know is this. When Jesus died for your sins, it was so that you could be forgiven, not that you could be reminded every day. It's so that you could put those sins just like God has behind you and press towards the mark which is in front of you. A lot of God's people and a lot of God's so-called Christians, they can't press on because they're still looking back. They can't press towards the mark because they're still tied to the things in the past. I'm just here to tell you, Jesus died for your sins so you not only could be forgiven, but also you could be forgotten about those sins as well. The Bible says, verse number 4, he says, "It's impossible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me." See, God had had his nostrils, the Bible says, plumb full of the bulls and the goats and the incense and all the offerings that man had offered. He needed something new. He needed something that was real. He needed something that would take his memories as well away from all the sins of the world. And there was only one thing that would do that. And that was the blood of his son, his darling son, his only begotten son. And the Bible says, Jesus said, that's the only thing that would suffice the Heavenly Father, was that perfect sacrifice. And that's who Jesus was. The Bible says in verse number, let's go on down to verse number 8. Verse 9, okay? "Then said he, Lo, I come to do thy will, Jesus said, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. By which we are all sanctified," I messed that up, "through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all." See, there is not a person upon the face of the earth that Jesus didn't die for. There has never been a person born upon the face of this earth that Jesus didn't die for. And there never will be. We got another little baby coming this week. They got a little baby right back there. And there will never be a person born upon the face of this earth that Jesus didn't come and die for. The Bible says there in verse number 10, once for all. He gave his life one time that all people, no matter what they've said, no matter what they've done, no matter what the sin they committed, no matter who they have treated, mistreated, or done wrong, Jesus' blood is more powerful than any sin ever has been. The Bible says in verse number 11, he says, "And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, the Lord Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Now this puts me in the mind of a lot of people as well. They do everything they particularly can to straighten their life out. They do everything that is almost humanly possible to get their life in order, to straighten it up, to make good of themselves, to get on the right path and be somebody in the community and be an example and be a help to those, maybe a good Boy Scout, a good Girl Scout, and just have a good testimony as being a good person. And people work hard to do that, but it ain't never going to take away your sin. You can be the best person you've ever been or anybody ever could be. You could be the Model A student at school. You could be the number one worker at work. You can cross all your T's, dot all your I's. You can be the very most individually liked person there is in the whole entire community or even in the church. But that ain't never going to take away your sin. The only thing that's ever going to take away your sin is what we just found here in verse number 11. Every high priest standeth daily ministering, offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. The only thing that's ever going to take your sin away, friend, is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because there's nothing as powerful as that blood. And you and your goodness will never accomplish what Jesus accomplished. He said in verse number 12, he said, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down on the right hand of God, and from henceforth expect until his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified, whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith Lord. I will put my laws, my word, into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and iniquities I will remember no more. Once again, Jesus did not, okay, it's worthy of saying again, Jesus did not give his life just so you could be forgiven. Jesus gave his life so your sins would be forgotten. They're already forgotten by God. And it is not and never will be God that throws up your sins in front of your face every single day or whenever you might say or do something wrong. That's not God. And if you, okay, I've heard people say down through the years, but you got to forgive yourself. Well, I had no problem forgiving myself because God forgave me. He's more powerful than I am. And if my Bible says that God forgave me, then I feel like I'm forgiven. Now, men and women may not forgive me, but that's their problem. That's not mine. Because who I'm going to stand before one day, a holy and righteous God, he was pleased when his son put the blood of his own body on the mercy seat and opened the door for me to be saved, and you as well. And when I walked through that door and got saved, then my sins have been forgiven. And they do not bother me no more. The Bible says in verse number 18, and now where remission of these is, the sins forgiven, there is no more offering for sin. Now that kind of goes along with the man and the chickens. He'll forgive you. No matter what you've said or done, he'll forgive you. No matter what the sin is, he'll forgive you. No matter the things that you might have said or thought, he'll forgive you. But he's only going to forgive you that one time, friend. Now listen to me. There's forgiveness every day, but there's stupidness every day too. Don't think Jesus is going to come and die for that man to go back and steal chickens again. Don't think that God's going to keep forgiving him over and over and over and over when he just wants to be a moron to start with. And for you and I that continue to do the same things, and we know the wrong. You know the wrong. You examine your life. That's what the Bible says. Examine yourselves, therefore. You examine your life. You say, well, I know there's things in my life that ain't right, okay? Well, I mean, did you ask God to forgive you? You say, yes, I did. Well, why ain't they right? Is it that you never really got forgiveness, never really asked for forgiveness, or you got forgiveness and you just don't care and just keep on doing what you're going to do? Well, as I say, and as the Bible says, God came and died for you one time. Jesus died for your sins one time. And the Bible says in Hebrews 10 and 26, if you look with me, okay, verse 26 says, for if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, then there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. See, you can play the preacher. You can play your husband, you can play your wife, and you can trick whoever and anybody that you want to about your life and how you live and who you are and stuff like that, okay? But you can't trick God. And you can't deceive God. So if there is sin in your life, okay, then you have the perfect opportunity to get forgiven for it. Because Jesus paid the price that you could. And once you get that forgiveness, guess what? That sin's gone. Not only are you forgiven, but also forgotten. That sin is forgotten. But now listen, if you ain't ever got forgiveness, how do you think you're going to get it unless you ever ask? And the Bible says, for he that willfully goes out and continues to do the same thing over and over and over as far as sin, Jesus paid for it once, friend. He won't pay for it no more. For those who believe, okay, in the doctrine that some teach about losing salvation, that's a bunch of hogwash. I mean, I ain't never lost nothing that Jesus has gave me, and Jesus has never lost nothing that God gave him. And what God gave him was my soul one day. And the reason why, because he paid that price for my soul. You can't lose that you couldn't earn to start with. Jesus, Bible says, Jesus bought and paid for my soul with his blood. So once my soul belonged to him, I am his. And you are his. And I have been forgiven. I didn't say I was perfect in no way, shape, or form. But I am forgiven this morning. Well, let me ask you, what about you? I mean, are you forgiven, truly forgiven? You say, well, preacher, I try to live a good life. That ain't what I asked you. I said, are you forgiven? The Bible teaches and tells us, as I read a while ago in verse number 4, it's impossible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. It's impossible if you live good enough to get to heaven without the blood of the Lord Jesus. See, God was looking, not only looking, but even smelling, if I can put it that way, for that sweet Savior that pleased him. The Bible says if you go back and read about the tabernacle and everything, you find out there was incense and things being burnt all the time. So there, not only do we know that our God has hands, the Bible says he's not a false God, he's not an idol, he has hands, he has eyes, he has ears. Of course, he must have a nose as well to smell the sweet Savior. And I tell you, there was no and never will be any sweeter smell than what he smelt the day that the Lord Jesus said, Father, it is finished. And he done all that so your sins could be forgiven. And the only way that Bible says this as well, okay? I got a few more, but I think it's about time to close. The only way that you're ever going to get to heaven is be forgiven by God, not man, not me, not nobody else, but by God. You have to be forgiven. And if you're holding on to your sins, okay, I don't know why. Not when the price has done been paid. And if your sins is what's holding you back from having the joy and the peace and the love that you need to be, okay, well, that's just on you. It's not God. God's not holding those sins over your head. You might say, well, preacher, you don't know what I've done. I don't care what you've done. And God don't either, if you're willing to ask forgiveness. But if you just want to sit there in your sin and just want to sit there and whine and moan and complain about you just can't get over this hurdle, okay? Well, God made a way. His name was Jesus. He came, and you've heard me say so many times, he came to set you free. Came to set you free. And if your sins have a hold on you, you're not free. If your sins are hindering you, you're not free. If your sins have got you all wrapped up in knots and things like that, and you just can't seem to find peace about it, then you're not forgiven. But if you're willing to ask God, he will forgive you, no matter what it might be. And you can walk out of this church this morning with your head held high, knowing that you are a forgiven individual, and Jesus is a reason why. Think about that. Brother Dustin, if you would, play us one or two verses of a hymnal. If it's where you can, you stand this morning. We'll give an altar call. We hadn't in a couple of weeks. And if you need to come, this altar's open, and I will meet you there myself. Don't let the devil keep you from getting the peace that Jesus died that you could have. What about it, friend? Anybody here this morning? You say, preacher, I don't have the peace and the joy that I want in my life. Won't you come up here and get it this morning? It's right here. It's free just for the coming, just for the receiving. Thank you. about it. Anybody else? Say, preacher, I know I need to come. Things ain't quite right. Well, come on. Why wait? Come on, make peace with the Lord this morning. Jesus died for your sins, friend. How precious that is. Anybody else this morning? Thank you, Dustin. All right, once again, thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for being a part of Old Union Church. If you ever need me, of course, I say it every single week. If there's anything at all I can do to help you in any way, don't never hesitate to call. And I'll be glad to always lend an ear. If I can help, I will. Don't forget Bible study Wednesday night at 6:30. If it's where you can, be a part of us. We are growing, and I'm very thankful and blessed by the people who are coming. Okay? And I just love you very much. We've got a hymnal we're going to sing. And so after the hymnal, then Dustin, if you would, dismiss us.
Step page 504. Turn page 504.
Thank you. be with all of us throughout the week.